morning to all of you.
Good morning,
Mr. Mungale, Dr. Deshpande, Dr. Nirlekar, distinguished panel members and students, faculty. It gives me great pleasure to be among you to discuss about new age HR. As has been told, that HR is going to face a big problem because automation is reducing the jobs, and ambition of everybody is to get a job in an MNC. And HR people are told that what is going to be placement, 20 lakh, 30 lakh, 40 lakh, 50 lakh. And that is how the institutions' performance is decided. What is the placement? But if placement themselves are going to go down because of automation. I tell you that auto industry has not hired a single person in the last 10 years. Yes, auto industry is booming. We'll see that during Diwali there will be so many cars and 2 wheels on the road, there will be further traffic jams. But are they providing jobs? They are not. And why they are not providing jobs? Because of the policies by government of India or the world of giving extra protection to the workers, which means, which leads the management to believe that it's better to invest in a robot or a special purpose machine or expensive machine than to invest in men or women. Because men and women becomes a kind of liability for them. So instead of from asset, they are become liabilities. So a big challenge for HR and for government is to change this mindset that manpower is a asset or a liability. Actually, it is an asset. Without manpower, you can't do anything. But people think it's a liability because they will be here permanency, with permanency, and you, even if they perform, they don't perform, their increment goes on, their job security is there. So how to come out of this difficulty? So what people are doing, they are going for contract labor, or they are going for outsourcing. And outsourcing is a good idea. Nothing wrong with it, but the small industry to whom the job is outsourced, is he capable of producing the required quality? Nowadays, people are talking of Six Sigma limits, that is, maximum 4 jobs allowed to be rejected in 1 billion. If you produce 1 billion jobs, only 4 are allowed to be rejected, that is Six Sigma. People are talking of Six Sigma limits. Possibly we are not at Six Sigma, possibly we are talking percentage, only 1% rejection or 0.1% rejection. But all over the world, people are talking of Six Sigma, and that's practiced in, say, automobile, or practiced in aircraft industry, practiced in nuclear industry. So, under such circumstances, from where the jobs will come? It's a big question, and I think people should answer that question. Fortunately, I think this question is not going to be so serious in India, because India is a poor country and it needs to build its infrastructure. So huge number of jobs are going to be available in construction industry. Huge number, yes, we heard that there will be 3D printing, but 3D printing of homes has to compete with the home built by hands. So until hands become expensive, 3D printing will be far away. So we need not worry about 3D printing taking away our jobs. We should focus on what are the opportunities for India. Definitely construction and infrastructure building is a huge opportunity which will absorb hundreds of millions of people in the next few years. But are we prepared for that? Are we making our construction industry competitive with the world, or competitive for India itself? Now you go and look for a flat. Flat cost 60 lakhs plus, of which 30 lakhs is the price of land itself. And of the balance 30 lakhs, what is the cost of material? Cost of material is 5 or 6 lakhs. 20% is the cost of material. Balance is what? Balance is all labor. labor, is it being practical, is it being used properly? Suppose that flat comes down from 60 lakhs to 30 lakhs or 20 lakhs. How many buyers will be there? And how much construction industry will boom? Just imagine. So our target has to be how to reduce the cost of our final product. If the flats are going to cost 60 lakhs and 1 crore and 3 crore and 5 crores, now when I say 60 lakhs, I quoted the minimum figure. But nowadays, flats are being sold for crores. How many people can afford? Very few. And then how many people can be engaged in that industry? So the trick is how to reduce the cost. How to reduce the cost is something which should engage our attention. As I was a student in America, and I was doing the job. I was in the first batch of people to produce microprocessor and electronic engineer. My father wrote to me that, come back to India, you want to make a moped. I asked him, what is a moped? So he said, moped is a vehicle for common man. So I thought he's talking of Volkswagen Beetle, something like that. So I said, okay, give me 6 months, I'll finish my project and come. I came, he said, no, moped is a vehicle, something between cycle and motorcycle. I said, but I'm an electronic engineer and how will I make a moped? He said, no, it is 15 lakh rupees, go make a moped. If you have any problem, every day you come to me, I'll solve your problem and help you. This is your project, you make it. I said, yes, I'll take this challenge. But how to go about doing it? So he said, first thing you do is to go and meet the likely customers and the mechanics. And ask them questions. So 6 months you keep asking, meeting people, you keep asking questions. So I went to mechanics, they said, well, you know, petrol is adulterated and it develops carbon in the cylinder head. And when you clean the carbon, it falls into the cylinder only and then spoils the whole cylinder block. So engine should be ulta instead of upside. Vertical, it should be upside down. So when we clean the carbon, it should fall down. So it gave me an idea that it did not be upside down, but it can be horizontal with the exhaust port pointing downwards. Then one mechanic said, look, whenever a customer comes to us, we have to, for any problem in clutch, we have to open the engine. The engine opening means what? It means removing the gasket, removing the oil, and then we charge minimum 100 rupees in those days. And then we repair the vehicle, and then the vehicle remains with us for 3 days, that fellow gets annoyed. So can you make a vehicle where clutch is different, engine is different, and gearbox is different? And separately approachable, so that if you have to repair the clutch, which is the most common thing to be repaired, you don't have to open the engine. I said, okay, keep that in mind. Then one person said, you know, the roads are bad and the tire gets punctured. For every removal of puncture, you have to remove the wheel. And that takes time. So can you remove the puncture without having to remove the wheel? So I said, okay, that guy, keep in mind. So like this, I gathered the inputs from the various customers. Then we designed the vehicle, as I said, this Luna, where all these things were incorporated. So my father had set a target that it should cost less than 2,000 rupees. It should weigh less than 50 kilograms. No foreign collaboration, no imported components, no imported machine, and factory in backward area. So with these targets I had to work. But, you know, because he had set those targets, then I said that, look, this is achievable enough, let's try. And we succeeded in making a vehicle below 50 kilograms, capable of carrying two people, negotiating on Indian bad roads, working on India's dusty atmosphere, adulterated petrol, and giving service for years. So once I went to Piaggio, Piaggio is a company which pioneered scooters. Those of you who have seen Roman Holiday or something like this, they are the pioneers of scooters, Vespa scooters. Once I went there, so in front of their R&D was Kedron Luna. I said, how come Luna is here? So he said, we bring it every year, one model, to know how you make a vehicle which can withstand your bad conditions and still runs. So we learn from you. So point I'm trying to make is, because we were on our own and because we were set a target, because we struggled, because there was no foreign collaboration, so to speak, we made a product which worked and we sold 50 lakhs of them. Not only that, Luna remains the only vehicle which has been exported from India to US. Why not export to US? Because US has very strict laws of product liability. If something goes wrong in the product, the manufacturer is responsible and the court awards damages of millions of dollars. So everybody is clear. Nobody from India has ever bothered to export a product, forgot about exporting, not even thought of exporting to US. But we exported 50,000 Luna to US. How? Were we foolhardy? No. I read in the law that assembler is also a manufacturer. So then I thought that Americans are very handy people. Why not let them assemble their own product? And they become manufacturers. They can't sue themselves. So I sent them kits in cardboard cartons with instruction how to assemble. And they assembled and they used. And I sold 50,000 kits. Now, see, Indian minds work against adversity or against challenges. So there are adversities, there are challenges. So we have to look for these challenges and that gives us the solution, what I will do. Now, we heard that there is mechanized farming in America. In India, mechanized farming is impossible because the land only is so small. But does it mean? Does it mean that farming is impossible? No. Farming can be in vegetables. Vegetable doesn't require 100 acre land. Vegetable requires few acres of land. You can become vegetable maker, fruit maker, strawberry maker of the world and export. Which country in the world has so much sunshine, so much rain, so much fertile, so much irrigated land? Only India has. But if you say, no, we want to make only food grains or we want to make only sugar cane, then you are in the wrong direction. If you say, I want to make vegetables and fruits and export to the world, I will import sugar cane, I will import food grains where it is cheaper, but I will export vegetables, I will export fruits. Then that gives employment to millions and hundreds of millions of people. Now you tell me, in the rural schools, do they teach agriculture? No. They are taught same physics, chemistry, maths that the students who want to go to engineering are taught. SSC course for rural boys and urban boys is same. If you are not taught agriculture, how will you get attracted to agriculture? You are only taught physics, chemistry, mathematics, history, geography, but not agriculture. So they don't get attracted to agriculture. But if you teach them how to do agriculture in a profitable way, probably they will think of agriculture as a profession. Now, how to make agriculture profitable? By focusing on two things. One is food processing. And not, don't grow just food grains, but process it. Now, if you heard of cryogenic grinding, if you heard of organic farming, what is cryogenic grinding? Cryogenic grinding is grinding at low RPM at low temperature. In our childhood, we know that there was ghatti. That ghatti was giving you grinding at low temperature, low RPM, and that retains the food value. And people are willing to pay double the value for grains which are ground at low RPM. So all we need is to go back to grinding. Similarly, kutai machines were there, people used to cut by hand. Now, I am not advocating that women or men should spend their time in gatti or chakki or kutai. But can we engage bulls? Can we engage bulls to go around and do grinding? And while going around, they can dehusk the food grains also. And while going around, can they compress air? Can this compressed air be used for generating the electricity? Yeah, all this is possible, theoretically possible, but we have not started working on developing the problem for rural India, where 100 crore Indians live. We have started thinking only of problem of urban India, where very few people live, and comparatively, and where jobs are scarce, but jobs are available in rural India. If you think of how to do food processing, how to use organic farming, how to use bull power for doing more work. Now you can't afford a bull because bull you have to feed every day, and bull is used only 60 days in a year. The other 300 days you have to keep feeding him. So people don't like bulls anymore. They like to hire cattle for a day or two and then be done with it. But bull can be employed for 360 days. If you think how to utilize bull for 360 days, how to use bull's muscle power to do this so-called cryogenic grinding or electricity generation, as I said, how to utilize bull? Because bull will give you dung also, food waste. And bull's dung together can give you gas. The gas can be used for cooking in the village itself. Gas can be used for various other things that you want. But are we applying our mind to developing solutions for rural India, where the real market lies? So my first recommendation to all of you guys is please apply your mind to developing solutions for rural India, where 100 crore people live and who are wanting to migrate to cities in search of jobs, and such jobs are not available. But if you give them solution in their own cities, in their own villages, then that's a glorious opportunity for you. Once I went to China, in the exhibition there was a machine, you put tomatoes on one side, you get ketchup bottle on the other side. Now, tomatoes are 5 rupees a kilo, 4 rupees a kilo to the farmer. Ketchup bottle is 100 rupees a kilo. Just by investing in a machine, you convert tomatoes to ketchup. They are able to convert 5 rupees a kilometer to 100 rupees a kilometer. And all the farmers in that village can bring their tomatoes and take ketchup bottles and sell. Now, can we make a ketchup making machine converting from tomatoes in a village? I'm talking of village level ketchup making machine. I'm not talking of a 100 crore wala ketchup making machine. I'm talking of village level ketchup making machine. If somebody develops a village level ketchup making machine, it will be great. Every village which grows tomato will have that. We heard that onion growers, they get only 1 rupee a kilo when the season comes. And whereas you have to pay 30, 40 rupees a kilo. What happens to be in between? It gets lost to middlemen in transportation, in chain of middlemen. Can onion be frozen? Can we develop a cold storage using solar system, solar power, and we develop a cold storage system using that for village. Village, if you say no, I will use whole storage by electricity, where electricity is not available for 20 hours in a day. It's no use. But solar power is definitely available for 6 to 8 hours. Can we make a solar power assisted cold storage for villagers? It's a great market. All villagers can store their produce in a cold storage, which may be underground, or any of you who have gone underground know it's cold down there. Underground cold storage using solar power. It's a great opportunity. Really great opportunity to develop in every village underground cold storage using solar power. We have to work on it. And those of you who are entrepreneurs can work on such things that will give rise to jobs in the rural market. Rural market is the real market, 100 crore ka market. Do you need a bigger market than that? There is no such market available in the world. Not even in America, not even in Europe. One of my friends said, he's settling in America, that his son told him that, "Dad, I'm going to India." He thought he's going for a summer holiday. He said, "It's very hot there, mind you." So, "No, I'm going for good." "You're going for good? Why?" "I came here to America." He says, "Dad, you don't know, now jobs are available only in India. India is a growing country, growing at 7.6% a year. America is growing at 1% a year. So real opportunities are in India, so I'm going to India." Dad said, "I came to America because I thought this is land of opportunity." So, "No sir, no dad, India is land of opportunity." But we are forgetting India is land of opportunity. And we are thinking that we are not going to have jobs. There are jobs. Another simple idea, I heard that your guys are developing a motor cum electric vehicle for low cost transportation. Yes, electric, small little electric three-wheeler is a very good idea. It will enable farmer to bring his produce directly to the city and sell it directly to consumer. Today, how does farmer bring his produce? 10 farmers put their stuff in a tempo, and tempo driver brings it to the city, and 10 farmers have to put 10 people to sell their stuff in the same tempo. They sit on the food packets and spoil it. But imagine a low-cost transportation, electric low-cost transportation, which will take the farmer's own produce from farmland to the city, will sell it and go back. Something costing, let's say, 30,000-40,000 rupees. You can afford, or government can give him some subsidy. But he will bring his produce and sell to you, not today selling at 1 rupee or 2 rupees a kilo to the market yard. Tomorrow he can sell directly to the consumer at 10 rupees a kilo. Consumer is buying at 40 rupees a kilo. He can buy at 10 rupees a kilo, so both will benefit. So, great market exists for developing a low cost transportation for individual farmer. Today there is a tempo or there is a bicycle. So, there is need for something in between. Bicycle cannot carry its produce, tempo is too expensive, but a low cost carrier for farmer, ready for electricity. Range 40 kilometers. Good idea. Like that, we have to think what are the various ideas whereby we can capture the market that there is. We have to just go around and ask people questions. What do you want? What would you like? And that question itself will give us the answers. So I don't despair that there is no market, there is no job. Jobs are there. You can create jobs. You don't have to work in MNC. Now, working for MNC, I tell you, is not such a great idea. Why? Because MNC sells on what? They sell on their advertisement, they sell on their brand name, they sell on their product quality, they sell on their name established by them for decades. Suppose you say work for Colgate or Hindustan Lever, what will you do? What work you have? Yes, you will have the air conditioned office, nice office, you will get good fat paycheck, but you learn nothing. Because Colgate toothpaste is sold on the brand name they have built for decades. You are not going to be able to sell Colgate toothpaste or contribute to Colgate toothpaste. So, you may be gold medalist, but you will become stagnant in MNC. So my straightforward advice to you is never go for MNC. Because you will stagnate. You will simply stagnate. Now the time has come where every 10 years, life is changing. 10 years suppose there was no internet. 10 years suppose there was no cell phone. 10 years from now, what will be there? I don't know. I can't even predict what will be there. You have to be ready to meet the challenge of what is going to happen 10 years from now. But if you work in MNC, you become a cushy job with superannuation and gratuity and pension and all that, you will stop thinking. And the moment you stop thinking, your stagnation starts. So, how did British people, you heard that Lord Macaulay gave a speech that these Indians are very hardworking and Maratha especially, they are the strongest force that opposed the British. Last people to fight with British were Maratha, Shinde, Holkar, Rani Lakshmibai, Peshwa, Tatyapati. And now you feel that the Marathas or Maharashtrians don't want to even go out of Pune. They want to stay in Pune only. Why? Because British people gave them these jobs with pension and gave them jobs that are permanent jobs, nobody can remove you. So they thought it's very good. I get every year's steady increment, I get pension, I don't have to worry about anything. So tension free life. So the Marathas became tension free. But that also removed the adventurous spirit from them. So those Marathas who were going beyond Attak, where is Attak? Attak is in Afghanistan. Who were dreaming of going to Tashkent. They now don't even want to go out of Pune because they got a cushy job. So going to MNC and taking a job, mind you, looks nice, but it will stunt your growth. So if you're going to MNC, then go with the idea of learning. That I'll spend for 3, 4, 5 years to learn how that company has become so big. How they have managed to make the product quality so good. How do they advertise? How do they do things? Learn. But keep in mind that 5 years from now, I will not be working for this MNC. I will be doing something of my own. What is that something of your own? You have to keep your mind and ears, your eyes and ears open. What is it that I want to do in my life? I had a friend whose father was the biggest grain merchant in Pune. And his father expected his son to carry on their business. So he told his son that, son, you have done your BCom. Now from next month, you please start sitting at the mandi, dukan. And I would like to retire. So his son said, no way, I'm not going to sit at grain, I'm not going to become a grain merchant. What do you want to be? So I want to become a musician. His father had a heart attack. A musician? How can you be a musician? And what will happen to all my business? So they didn't talk to each other for a year. Then the mother interlinked. She said, at least talk to each other. The father said, okay, musician is not acceptable to me. Grain merchant business is not acceptable to you. Let's think of something else. He said, okay, then I would like to become a rose farmer. I would like to grow roses. So father said, okay, I'll buy you a farmland and you can grow roses there. So he said, but I'll stay on the farmland. He said, hey, okay, you stay on the farmland. So father bought a big farmland, built a nice house for him. He became the biggest rose exporter from Pune. After 15-20 years, he said, I want to sell off that land. don't want to become, those export doesn't inspire me anymore. What inspires you? I want to become a painter. He has become a painter. And every week he produces a painting and sells for lakhs of rupees. So imagine, he was an artist, he's an artist, and he wants to change his life. Every 10 or 15 years he wants to change his direction. And he makes good money because he works in the domain of his passion. So my advice to you guys is to please work in the domain of your passion. Don't work for somebody else, work for yourself. Pursue your passion. Did Sachin Tendulkar become graduate or double graduate? No. But he pursued his passion. You ask Chandu Borde, Sachin Tendulkar used to work, practice late night at 12 o'clock. So he lived his cricket all of his life. So he became passionate about it. So he succeeded and he became number one in the world. So you have to work for your passion. You don't have to become doctor or engineer or work for MNC or work for this and that. You just pursue your passion. Identify your passion. How to identify your passion? It's very difficult. But you have to be ready to, you know, find your way out. You might think this is my passion. Tomorrow you might think something else, then you might think something else, then you might think something else. So who will help you? Now the biggest thing that can help or come to our aid is not parents, not teachers, but Wikipedia and smartphone. All you need is a smartphone and Wikipedia. Through smartphone and Wikipedia, you can learn anything you want. So as you go up in life, you got learning what others have done, what you can do, what are the ways. So keep yourself abreast of the world by using your smartphone and Wikipedia. These are going to be your two teachers. So please follow your life through Wikipedia and smartphone. There is no need for you to say, my father taught me this or my teacher taught me this. Yes, they taught you, they prepared you. Prepared you for what? For keeping on learning, keeping on developing yourself. So in school or college or even later in life, what you need to do is to keep on learning, keep on developing yourself. Unfortunately, in India, there is a system that there is a brahmacharya ashram, where you are a student, you learn. There is a grihastha ashram, where you become a family man and you stop learning. You work. And then there is sannyasa ashram, where you stop working. No, now life has changed. Now you are no more. There are no more three or four stages. During your grihastha ashram also you have to follow your learning. So evening colleges, evening courses are as important as day courses. In America, as you probably know, people don't go home from work. Don't go home for drinking their cup of tea or eating poha. They go home via a evening college where they learn something on before reaching home. Why do they go through that evening college? Because something new has come up and they want to go up in life, they want to improve their skill set. So can we start? Of course, Marathwada Mitramandra has so many institutes, but can we start evening colleges where people working in industry will enhance their skill set? Whatever they want to learn, somebody wants to learn marketing because he thinks that there is a good opening in marketing. Somebody wants to learn finance. He thinks if he has to become general manager, then he has to learn finance. Like that, somebody wants to learn engineering, somebody wants to learn workshop. So allow them to improve their skill set so that they can keep on improving and learning. Let them improve. All the while, everybody should keep on learning, keep on working. Your job of the institute is to give them basic training. When I was in IIT, it was a 5-year course. 3 years we learned physics, chemistry, maths. That's all. Only 2 years we learned engineering. 3 years we learned physics, chemistry, maths. But I can tell you, For me, transition from electronic engineer to mechanical engineer was easy because I had learned physics, chemistry, and maths. If tomorrow you tell me that you become a chemical engineer, I may be able to do so within 6 months because I learned so much. So basic foundation is laid by your college, but you have to build your career on that foundation. You have to keep on learning. You have to keep on thinking what I will do next. You have to keep on doing that, something next. When I went to America once, a friend of mine came to receive me at the airport. And I was talking on phone. I said, is it allowed to talk on phone while driving? So, no, I am doing something very important. And I said, let me drive. So he said, okay, you drive. So I drove and he was talking on the phone. By the time we reached his home, he said, very good. I said, what is very good? He said, I sold my company. I said, selling your company is very good. He said, yeah, I sold my company. And now what will you do? I'll work for the same company. But you sold your company and you'll work there as what? As a transitional manager to ensure that this company will continue the good work that I have done. I said, doesn't it bother you that when you are a big boss, you will become a manager? He said, no, because I will be working on my new project. Here I will only help those guys to continue the work and guide them, and I will work on my new project. I said, this you will do for how many years? Said, every 5 years I will work on your project. So every 5 years you are going to make a company, sell it at a profit. Invest that much money into a new project, for which means he has to learn a new theme, new technique, because he knows that his company is there only for 5 years. After that, he has to develop a new company. So he has to, while working, he has to develop the skill and ability to make a new company and new technique and new technology. So in America, people are, especially we heard of Silicon Valley and Google and all that. All these people are working on something that is going to happen after 5 years. While continuing their present job, they are thinking of something else. So even if you are working somewhere, I would say that think of something that will happen. Even if you are an entrepreneur, don't get wedded to that company. Think that, okay, this company may go away. I'll do something else. But always do things that about which you are passionate. That is the mantra for success. So thank you very much for listening to me. I really enjoyed talking. If you have any questions, I would be willing to answer.
Hello?
Yeah.
I want to found a software which is very useful to farmer only. But I didn't get any clue. So how can I think that get a clue regarding the farmer only? Because when I am going to develop any software, it is useful only for the citizen people. But I never think about the farmer who can use that software. So how can I think about that farmer so that I can develop
it? So I will give you one example. My grandfather, who stayed in Marathwada, in Bid, he was a grain merchant. And yeah. He had other business also, but one of them was this. And he had a business associate in Latur, another place in Marathwada. Every day he used to send a postcard to his associate in Latur that in Bid there are the prices of food grains and vegetables, etc., etc., like this, and so much material is available. And every day he used to get a postcard from Latur. And they had a understanding that where price is more in Latur, send the material, don't ask. And where price is less in Bid, Latur, well, send the material. So this is the postcard internet, postcard e-marketing. So idea existed that you must know each other where the market is and you have to export. Send your material to where the market is. So software, of course, there is e-chopal and there are other softwares made. But how to teach people to use that software is also a challenge, because farmers are uneducated. But in every village, there is somebody who is able to operate your software. So writing new software may not be required, but teaching that software for people to use to their advantage may be required. So one of the ideas I may suggest to you is, please establish a software center in the villages to teach one smart chap in that village to use your software or each of our software to do trading. Another idea, precision farming. Precision farming requires what? The university at Aurangabad or at Rahuri or Pune, there are experts in these universities who can give guidance to the farmer on how much fertilizer to use, whether to irrigate or not. All these guidance farmers can receive from them. But our expert is sitting in Pune or Rahuri, he is not in the farm. But your software can give the input of soil moisture, of soil acidity, pH value, of electrical conductivity, of atmospheric moisture, temperature, how by mounting sensors for this on a plow, and a farmer while plowing the land can use this sensors to transmit the data to the expert sitting in Pune. That expert sitting in Pune can analyze the data in his computer and give advice. Okay, for 3 days no water, but put so much urea. The farmer will double his output if he receives the expert advice on precision farming. So I would say precision farming is a very good area for a person like you to develop a software where farmer can send his data automatically. Farmer doesn't know what is pH value, but sensor knows. So that the data can go to the university guys who can give them advice. Similar is the case of whether there is going to be any disease. The farmers, they grow their plants, but there is disease. So whether this is going to come, and you have to put your pesticide before the disease arrives. And after disease arrives, you will have to put 10 times more pesticide. But if you put that preventive pesticide before the disease arrives, you need to use very little pesticide. So how to know whether disease is going to arrive? By having sensors at various places. You know that it has come up to Nanded. From Nanded to Aurangabad, it will take another 1 week to come. In that 1 week, you alert the farmer that, Baba, if this disease is going to come, you please put a little bit of pesticide right now, so that this disease will not bother the crop. So such preventive measures also you can develop and help the farmers. So trading, precision farming, disease prevention, and hundreds of ways are there. You just have to go to the farm and talk to the farmers, and you will yourself find hundreds of them. If you sit in Pune and say, I want to develop a software for farmers, it is no use. It will not work. You have to decide that I will make my life there, go and stay put there. First thing is you build yourself a nice home there with a toilet and stay there. And after you stay there, then you will come to know their problems, then you will find the solutions. Any other question? Yes, sir.
You spoke on following the passion. So my question is, the way we are trained, right from the school days, the mindset is prepared for the students. So if we have to recognize the passion, so how do we recognize it? Can you give some suggestions for that?
Yeah, first you tell the parents not to brainwash their children. First and foremost problem is parents telling the children that you must become doctor or engineer or go to bank or go to MNC. So first, stop parents from brainwashing the children. Secondly, it is difficult for somebody who is 10 or 12 year old to know what is going to be his attitude or aptitude. So, but there are aptitude tests which can give you some idea. But then, can our educational system identify your aptitude and give you projects in that area of your aptitude and then see whether you really like that? And then those projects can be jointly with your parents, because parents also should know your, whether you are in an aptitude or not. But unfortunately, our curriculum is so straight-jacketed, doesn't allow you to think what is your aptitude. Doesn't allow you to develop your passion. You have to learn your physics, chemistry, maths. So what is the use of algebra, you tell me, to a farmer? There is no use of teaching algebra to a farmer. Yeah, he should know a little bit of arithmetic, maybe a little bit of geometry. That's okay, too, because he has to know how to calculate his area of his farm. Little bit of arithmetic and geometry is okay, but why to teach him algebra? So we have to make these things optional and allow you to pursue those matters in which your career is going to be made. So our system has to be quite flexible from school days. Today I understand that there is some flexibility at postgraduate level. It's too late. You already decided that you are going to be IT engineer, and then you are told no, your talent is somewhere else. And so it's too late. So in school itself, your aptitude has to be known. Now, just an aside, you can sit out this. Just an aside, in our company, we wanted to know what is the aptitude of our workers' children. So we got a lady from Pune to do an aptitude test. So she gave the aptitude test to the workers' children. And she said, I will announce you the results, whose aptitude is what. But I also want to know what you want to be. So we all expected that there will somebody will say, I want to become pilot, I want to become astronaut, I want to become engineer. My father is a worker, but I want to become an engineer, a doctor. But the number one choice that boys vote is police. Number one choice for boys was police. Number two was politician. So we were shocked to know that these are the role models of people, police and politician. Why? Because they make easy money. So we need to change the mindset of our, of course they learn from their parents only. To police ban rahe baba, to rajkarni ban rahe baba. So parents have to be also brought into the picture of telling the boys or girls what is the correct direction in life. Mehnat karun shik. Mehnat is just So it is very important that parents also have to be taught. Not only boys and girls, but parents also have to be brought into the picture if you want to know the aptitude and you want to change the direction of the young boys and girls. Because at that age, parents' cooperation is very important. Parents have this idea of safety that let my boy or girl become a take up a steady government job or a steady agency job and let him be happy in his life. But that happiness may be short-lived. You know, in America, all these big companies merely lay off people. I know of many of my friends who are out of job for years. And who work because their wives also work and therefore they are able to, you know, meet both ends meet. But working for big companies also can expose you to danger of being laid off. In India, that day has not come, but it will come. that your fascination for working these companies, you are exposing yourself to danger of being laid off. So better to stand on your own two feet, to know your own aptitude. So aptitude tests and parents' mindset change, both are important. One last
question. My question is, when you are studying, what are the things that you are being told by?
Pardon?
When you are studying, what was that thing that you are being motivated?
When you are studying, what was that thing?
Struggling.
No, my father helped me. Every day I used to go to him and say that, give this help to him, bring up so and so. So my son is embarking on this project. He'll come to you for advice, please help him. So he wanted to make press tools. So I said, how to make press tools for our liquor? He said, don't worry, we'll go to Mr. Mughalkar of Telco. So he took me to Mr. Mughalkar. He said, my son wants to do this project, vehicle for common man. He wants dyes. So can you make dyes in telco? So Mughalkar said, do for others, but since you have come, I'll do it for you. So my father said, also please charge him only material cost. So he said, okay, I'll charge only material cost. Then I said, look, you know, we have to. We can't afford so many machines. We need a SPM, special purpose machine, which HMT can develop. So no problem. Rang up Dr. Patil. Dr. Patil, my son wants an SPM. Please come with your chief designer. So Dr. Patil came to the chief designer. Then my father said, you guys, we will talk, but you guys discuss. In the evening, don't come to conclusion. So we discussed with his chief designer, and he said, yes, it's possible to do 5 components in one SPM. Then his chief designer said, yes, sir, it is possible to do 5 components in one SPM as he wants. My father said to Dr. Patil, project jo hai, thoda cost kam laga usko. So he said, okay. Like that, my father did help me time to time to come out with solutions. We had to make a paint shop. Now paint shop requires huge investment. But we read that you can use gas infrared bulbs for painting. Where to get gas? In those days gas was difficult. So we told our workers, see, everybody should bring one LPG gas cylinder. You require at home, so you get one and your name, one on your wife's name, and get one for us and bring it to company so that we can use LPG gas cylinder for infrared heating of the painted part. So every worker brought his gas cylinder, one every month, and helped us. So if you ask for help and you want help, people are ready to help you. You have to ask for help, you have to think what help to ask. So people are ready to help you if your project is worth helping. So but please make a project which is to the benefit of common man. So my father told me that you may earn a lot of money. Whenever, if you are hardworking, you will earn a lot of money. But please make sure that you develop, you make a difference in the life of people. Your product should make a difference in the life of people. Then people will want your product. So this is the Guru Mantra. Please work on a project which will make a difference in the life of our Indian people, of which there are 125 crores. Don't work for somebody who is in America. Work for people in India. Thank you, sir.